About one-third of our nephrons have long loops of Henle dipping down into the medulla of the kidneys. The function of the loop of Henle is to conserve water and thus prevent dehydration. The longer the loop of Henle, the more concentrated the urine that can be produced. This is a very useful adaptation to life on land. Birds and mammals are the only vertebrates with loops of Henle. The urine of a human can be 4 to 5 times as concentrated as the blood. The drier the natural habitat of an animal, the longer its loop of Henle. This is to conserve as much water as possible. So for example, the beaver, which is a semi-aquatic mammal, has a very short loop of Henle and produces a large volume of dilute urine. On the other hand, the kangaroo rat, which lives in the desert, has a long loop of Henle and produces small volumes of highly concentrated urine. Their urine is 6 to 7 times more concentrated than human urine, and they do not need to drink water. They get enough from food and metabolic water produced during cell respiration. Humans have a mixture of both long and short loops of Henle, as seen in the previous video. The loop of Henle has 3 distinct regions, each with its own function. These are: number 1, the descending limb, which has thin walls. Number 2, the thin ascending limb. This is the lower half of the ascending limb and has thin walls like the descending limb. And number 3, the thick ascending limb. This is the upper half of the ascending limb and has thick walls. The first part of the loop of Henle is called the descending limb, and the second part is the ascending limb. The difference between these two is their permeabilities, as we shall see. The process can be thought of as starting in the thick ascending limb. The entire ascending limb is impermeable to water. The cells in the thick part of the ascending limb can selectively reabsorb sodium, chloride, potassium, and other ions from the tubule. They actively transport sodium and chloride ions out of the cells of the ascending limb into the surrounding tissue fluid of the medulla, specifically by means of a sodium-potassium pump via active transport. Sodium ions then diffuse from the fluid in the ascending limb into the cells of the ascending limb to replace the sodium ions lost. As they do, they pass through a carrier protein which also accepts chloride and potassium ions. These are co-transported into the cells with sodium ions against their concentration gradients and diffuse out with sodium ions into the medulla. The whole process is driven by the sodium-potassium pump and results in sodium, potassium, and chloride ions accumulating in the tissue fluid of the medulla. Therefore, the concentration of these ions in the ascending limb decreases, while the concentration in the medulla increases. This increases the water potential of the fluid inside the nephron and decreases the water potential outside it. Normally, water would follow by osmosis the movement of these ions into the cells, but this cannot occur because the cells are impermeable to water as stated. Therefore, water cannot pass out of the nephron at this point. The fluid in the descending limb therefore becomes very dilute by the time it reaches the distal convoluted tubule. On the other hand, the descending limb is highly permeable to water and permeable to most solutes. Its function is to allow substances to diffuse easily through its walls. As the fluid from the tubule flows through the descending limb, it passes through the tissues into which sodium and chloride ions have been pumped. The high concentration of salts in the medulla makes water leave the descending limb by osmosis, as there is a water potential gradient and water moves down this gradient from inside the descending limb into the tissues outside it. This causes the descending limb to get more concentrated. Some ions do move out of the descending limb, but water moves much more rapidly. The loop of Henle is known as a countercurrent multiplier. The term countercurrent refers to the fact that the fluid flows in opposite directions in the two sides of the loop, down one side and up the other. Also, take note of the constant removal of sodium and other ions from the ascending side and their replacement from the proximal convoluted tubule on the descending side. This brings us to the final section, which looks at the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct.